Yeah, so last week we read from 319 to 314. And actually, what was the first question? The homework that I had given was bhakti stages for Ranga. So one at a time, raising of hands. I don't want unmuting, please. Raise your hand if you have done the homework. And I want, what is the Anga's name? What does it mean? And an example of a devotee. Simi Mataji, go first.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Mataji. The first one is Shravanam. Shravanam means hearing the names and glories of Sri Krishna. Mm-hmm. And the example is Parikshit Maharaj listening to Sukhdev Maharaj reciting the Srimad Bhagavatam.
Perfect. Thank you. Lower your hand. After you're done doing it, please lower your hands. Uma Mataji, go ahead.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Mataji. The next one is, should I tell all the thing or I must tell only the next?
One at a time. Let's give everybody a chance, Mataji.
Okay. Next one is chanting Kirtanam. That is, Sukhdev Goswami spoke about the Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam to Maharaj Parikshit. So that is Kirtanam. And also doing this Nama Japa is also, Hare Krishna Mahamantra is also one of the Kirtanams.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you. Simha Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Remembering Vishnu Smaranam. Example is Prahlad Maharaj never forgot Krishna despite of constant torture from his father, Hiranyakashipu.
Beautiful, Mataji. Next one, Sri Priya Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Next is Pada Sevanam. That is, example is Goddess Lakshmi at the feet of Vishnu always.
Perfect. Okay. My mother, Mataji. Yes, go ahead.
First one is Arkanam, worshipping of the deity, mm-hmm. Prithu Maharaj.
And what did he do with that? So he, a deity worships, and Prithu Maharaj used to use all his royal, opulence to try and use that towards Krishna consciousness. Great. Who else is there? What about other people? Anybody who has not heard? Roshan Prabhu, what's the next one? Roshan Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Mataji, I want to hear from devotees.
No, I want to hear from you, Prabhu. Class mein ghusoge to answer to karna padega. So we did till Pada Sevanam. What's the next one, Prabhu? Oh, no, sorry, Archana. What's the next one, Prabhu?
Mataji, you are a
team. Are you bold though?
Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, Padasanam, Archanam. It is Archanam after that.
Archanam ho gaya, uske baad.
Okay, that is Vandanam.
Perfect. Example, Prabhu.
Mataji, I think you can tell.
Nahi, you tell.
The example is of Krishna's uncle, Akrur Maharaj.
Beautiful, perfect, Prabhu. Okay, who's the... thank you, Prabhu. Thank you for participating. Baki on homework nahi kiya. Simi Mataji, what's the next one?
Next one is Dasyam Mataji. That is serving Lord as a servant.
Okay.
Example is Lord Hanuman serving Rama.
Beautiful, perfect. Who else? Umakandan Mataji, you already spoke, right?
Yes, Mataji.
So let's give Meera Mataji. Go ahead.
Sakyam Arjuna or Radha?
Sakyam Mataji, it will only be Arjuna. Okay. Final one. Who wants to? Where is Dr. Rao? Is he not here in the class? He submitted the homework. Let's say. Okay, Dr. Prakash Parekh.
Vatsalyam.
No, Prabhu, we are talking about not the rasas, we are talking about the anga, bhakti angas. So we did Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Samaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakhyam. What's the last stage?
I don't know, Mataji.
No worries, Prabhu, thank you. Asima Mataji, go ahead.
Atma Nivedanam. Mm-hmm. Example is, that's complete surrender. Bali Maharaj gave... Sri Vamana Dev, his entire kingdom, his possession, as well as own body, although his guru told him not to do it.
Beautiful. Perfect. Thank you so much. So please all lower your hands. That was the homework. Hopefully you guys read the verses before coming to the class. So just a few questions from the verses. 3.9, there is a phrase. You can open up your books and see if you can answer that. Tad artham, what does that mean in verse 3.9? Book uthao, open book hai. Itna sannata kyun hai, Meera Mata ji?
Yes, Hare Krishna. Mm-hmm. But tadartham means for the sake. For the sake of.
So what does that mean in that particular reference? For the sake of what? What are we doing there? For the sake of?
Performing your duties for the satisfaction. And in the way, you will always remain free from bondage.
So sake of what again, Mataji? I didn't hear you.
Prescribed duties for satisfaction of the... performing our duties. He is asking to do the duties for satisfaction of the Lord.
Perfect. Yeah. So tadartha means for the sake of who? Krishna. So when work is done as a sacrifice for Vishnu, there is no bondage associated with that. So that's the advantage of doing work in Krishna consciousness. 3.2 in the purport, and it's something that we have repeated again. What does the word mean? Vedasche sarve aham e vedya. What does that mean? What does that line mean? Jigna Mataji.
No, Mataji, by mistake it happened. Sorry.
Answer.
I didn't hear Mataji. Please repeat, Mataji. I was looking for my specs actually.
In verse 3.10, purport mein likha hua hai, Vedasche sarve aham eva vedya. What does that line mean?
Mataji, give me 2 minutes. I need to search my specs. Just give me 2 minutes.
You're fine.
I'm
That's sorry. Okay, Mataji. Let's...
Sorry. I'm looking for my specs.
Give You're me fine, Mataji. Koi apologies ka nahi zarurat nahi hai. I saw... Yeah. Who did I see? I just saw somebody raising their hand here. Meera Mataji?
Yeah, I am the Veda. He says, "Aham Vedaischa Sharva Aham Eva Vedya." So he says he is the Veda himself.
Or is it mean that the purpose of reading the Vedas is to get to Krishna, right? So the purpose of the Vedas is to know him. Yeah. So if you know him, the scriptures don't really matter because the end goal of the Vedas is to understand Krishna. Okay. I need a bit more participation. Kisi ne padha nahi hai kya class mein? Homework bol ke rakha tha. Where is the next question? What is the meaning of the word Sankirta Yagna? Raise your hands, please. This is a very simple question. Okay, Simi Mataji.
Chanting Hare Krishna mantra.
Okay. Why is it called a Yagna? Perfect. Yes. Thank you. And it is the prescribed one in the Kali Yugas to do the Sankirta Yagna. Perfect. Verse 3.11. What is the word define demigod? Who's a demigod? I see only the three hands raised. I need nude hands raised. Khushbu Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
The demigods are empowered administrators of material affairs. The supply of air, light, water, and other benedictions for maintaining the body and soul of every living entity entrusted to demigods.
Beautiful. That is perfect. Okay. In the same verse, 3.11, there's a sequence of steps that is given where it explains what is the advantage of eating food that is offered as a prasadam versus eating food as that. So when you eat food that is offered as a prasadam, what does it do to a human body? Like, well, how does it improve our Krishna consciousness? I need step by step. We went through it with a slide that Mataji has shared. Who can tell me that? I need, please, a little bit more raised. Rama Sheshi Mataji, go ahead.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Lord Krishna created the material world. Then it gave rise to the living entities. They came into being. Then they gave Vedas. Vedas also teach us to do our prescribed duty like a farmer. Then this is sacrifice. And then this brings about rain. And from rain, we get grain. Grain grows. And with this grain, we cook food. And this food is again offered to God. And if we don't offer it to God, it becomes a sin.
Okay, perfect, Mataji. You're explaining me the cycle of sacrifice. That's great. My question was, in verse 3.11, it's very precise. Explain what happens after we eat a food that is offered as Krishna Prasadam.
Cleanses our soul, purifies our soul.
Step by step, Mataji. You're correct. Step by step. Paragraph ke last mein, Simi Mataji.
It gets sanctified and then it purifies us, the food.
Again, you're missing a few steps.
Hold on.
Let's not talk over each other. Shanta Mataji, go ahead. Where did it go?
Can I say, Mataji?
Who's this? I can't see. Please say your name.
Uma Kannan.
Uma Mataji, go ahead.
Yes, Mataji. It is... existence becomes purified and memory becomes sanctified, and the path of liberation is easy.
Perfect. So the first step is when you offer food as a Krishna Prasadam, the eatables become sanctified. When we eat the eatables which are sanctified, our existence becomes sanctified. When the existence becomes sanctified, our finer tissues and our memory become sanctified. When the finer tissues become sanctified, then we think of liberation. And when we are in the stage of thinking constantly about liberation, we get into the path of Krishna consciousness. So try and remember it, because that's how you will recollect it on the points. 3.12, Yo Bhukte Stena Eva Saha. What does that mean? Jigna Mataji.
Mataji, it was previous question which I was knowing, not this one.
No worries. No. Yeah. Sorry, nahi. Meera Mataji, would you like to take?
Enjoying those gifts without them to gods. He's known as a thief.
Yeah. So any.
Tena eva saha.
Perfect.
So Bhunte is enjoying. He becomes tena is thief. He becomes thief.
So if you eat eatables which are not, because it has been through the grace of Krishna and demigods, and if we don't offer it back and we're eating it, then we are nothing less than a thief. Verse 3.13. What does the word santas mean? Okay, kuch nahi hath to khade kar lo yaar, wohi 4-5 log badh ke aate hain. Shri Priya Mataji, did you answer?
I did answer.
Okay, so then let's give a chance to another one. Shanta Mataji, I saw your, yes. Did you answer?
Devotee.
Yes. It's okay, go ahead.
Supreme Lord.
You might want to check your audio, Mataji. I think you said devotees of Krishna who are constant Krishna consciousness are, yes.
Krishna consciousness are called santas.
Perfect. Okay, so Swati Mataji, let me share the screen and we can start reading. Thank you so much for reading and coming. I would like a little bit more participation next time. 28 log aur usme 6-7 logon ne aur 8 logon ne maximum padh ke aaye hain. So please read. There's no other way you're going to understand. So where is my share screen? Let's see. We have to start from verse 3.15. And Swati Mataji, you'll start.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Mataji.
Karma Brahmo, text 15. Karma Brahmod Bhavam Vidhi Brahmakshara Samod Bhavam Tasmat Sarva Gatam Brahma Nityam Yadne Pratishthita. Purport. First translation. Mataji's quote. Regulated activities are prescribed in Vedas, and the Vedas are directly manifested from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Consequently, the all-pervading transcendence is eternally situated in acts of sacrifice. Purport. Yajnartha karma, or the necessity of work for the satisfaction of Krishna only, is more added in this verse. If we have to work for the satisfaction of the Yajna Purun, we must find out the direction of work in Brahman or the transcendental Vedas. The Vedas are therefore codes of working directions.
Madhaji, can you check your audio? Madhaji. Swati Madhaji. I'm sorry, can you
hear?
It's breaking up. Is there any Seema Madhaji, can you
Can I continue or not?
One second, Madhaji. Is anybody else hearing the break or is it just me?
No, there was my voice was cracking.
There was a break.
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, Madhaji, try one more time, please, because your voice is breaking completely.
Now you can hear? Clearly.
Yes, perfect. Can you start from the beginning, Madhaji? From the beginning of Purport?
Yes. Yajnartha karma, or the necessity of work for the satisfaction of Krishna only, is more expressly stated in this verse. If we have to work for the satisfaction of the Yajna Purusha, Vishnu, then we must find out the direction of work in Brahman or the transcendental Vedas. The Vedas are therefore codes of working directions. Anything performed without the direction of the Vedas is called Vikarma or unauthorized or sinful work. Therefore, one should always take direction from the Vedas to be saved from the reaction of work. As one has to work in ordinary life by the direction of the state, similarly, one has to work under direction of the supreme state of the Lord. Such directions in the Vedas are directly manifested from the breathing of the supreme personality of Godhead. It is said, Asya Mahato Bhutasya Nashvasitam Itadaya Rigveda Yajura Veda Samaveda. The four Vedas, namely the Rigveda, Yajurveda, Samaveda, and Atharvaveda, are all emanations from the breathing of the great personality of God. The Lord, being omnipotent, can speak by breathing air, as it is confirmed in the Brahma Samhita. For the Lord has the omnipotence to perform through each of his senses the actions of all other senses. In other words, the Lord can speak through his breathing, and he can impregnate by his eyes. In fact, it is said that he glanced over material nature and thus fathered all living entities. After creating or impregnating the conditioned souls into the womb of material nature, he gave his directions in the Vedic wisdom as to how such conditioned souls can return home back to Godhead. We should always remember that the conditioned souls in material nature are all eager for material enjoyment. But the Vedic directions are so made that one can satisfy one's perverted desires, then return to Godhead, having finished his so-called enjoyment. It is a chance for the conditioned souls to attain liberation. Therefore, the conditioned souls must try to follow the process of Yajna by becoming Krishna conscious. Even those who cannot follow the Vedic injunctions may adopt the principles of Krishna consciousness, and that will take the place of performance of Vedic Yajnas or Karmas. Thank you, Mataji.
Perfect. So in this particular verse, they're talking about regulated activities are prescribed in the Vedas, and the Vedas are directly manifested from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Vedas here are compared to like the codes of working direction. As human beings and as living entities, what are we doing? We are, how did we come into existence? We are eternally part and parcel of Krishna. But at some point of time, we had a little bit more of false ego in us. So what's the difference between, if I have to ask, the difference between what is ego and what is false ego? I don't want interpretation, I think so. I want you to know if you can tell me the difference between the two words. What is ego and what is false ego? Who can tell me that?
Ego is one...
This has been said in the 18 days. Mataji has repeated it quite a few times. Anybody? Raise your hands, please. Ego and false ego. So the difference there is, ego is I understand that I'm an eternal servitor of Krishna, that my job is to be in constant service of Krishna. And what is false ego? False ego is when I start thinking that I am the doer and I'm going to be the enjoyer associated with that, right? So what the Vedas here are doing is they're giving us a direction for the living entities to say what needs to be done and what does not need to be done. Anything which is prescribed and any activity that is prescribed, which is against the Vedas or is against the prescribed duties, called as Vikarma, because it is unauthorized and sinful work. So we have to follow till we come to the stage where we are realized and we are in complete transcendental consciousness of Krishna. Till then, in order to give us a code of, you know, I'm still involved in this material nature. I'm still doing what my nature tells me to do. But if I follow the directions of Veda, I'm regulating my activities in such a way that I am trying to go back to Krishna. So the activities have to be regulated. And where is the regulation coming from? The regulation is coming from the Vedas that has been prescribed. It also speaks about, when Krishna was, when the Lord was creating the 11 entities, he just glanced over at material nature and all living entities were created because the living entities wanted to enjoy the service, enjoy anything and everything other than Krishna. So he said, well, okay, you want to enjoy here. I'm creating this material earth with all the things that you would need. Go ahead and enjoy. And when you're satisfied and you want to come back to me, I'm going to give you a code of how to come back to me. And that code is nothing but the Vedas. So once a living entity is ready to come back to Krishna, he's also provided that also. Why? Because we are in something called as like the Tatha Shakti mode, the living entities, where sometimes I am in Krishna consciousness, sometimes I want to enjoy materially. So Krishna has provided for everything. Whether you want to enjoy, here is a material worth. If you want to come back to me, here are the Vedas. Use the dictionary, come back to me. Follow the principles associated with that. Also talking about Krishna can do anything with his, can do everything with each one of his senses. Through his eyes, he's impregnating, the material earth. He can eat through his feet. He can smell through his feet. So our senses are only doing one particular activities versus Krishna's senses. He's able to do any activity that is associated with that. Now, what is that property called? It is Daksh Guna. What is that word called? I'm not asking something which is out of syllabus. This has been said before. What kind of guna is that? When we say Krishna, can you guys unmute yourself here or no? Itna sannata kyun hai? Yeah, okay. Umakanand Mataji.
Mataji, Shuddha Tattva.
Shuddha Sattva is a higher level. No, Mataji. It's a guna. Shanta Mataji.
Nirguna.
Perfect. Yes, because you can the Mayavadis think about Nirguna as Krishna not having any senses, but what it basically means is each one of his senses has the capability of doing the work of his other senses. We should always remember that the conditioned souls in the material nature are all ego for material enjoyment, and Krishna is providing for it. But the Vedas that have been given are also given to us by Krishna, so that when we are done enjoying all this material life and we want to go back to the Godhead, he's giving us a prescription, do this, 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 and then you'll come back to me. So that is what is explained in this particular verse. Does anybody have any questions, comments, anything that you did not understand? Are yaar, yes, no, maybe. Ek hi cheez bulwate rehte ho. Kuch to bolo.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Yes, Mataji.
See, Vedas, that fourth, if I want to go back to Krishna, so all the descriptions are written in Veda, or I didn't get that particular point. If you want to go back to Krishna.
Yeah, so it is kind of like a manuscript, Mataji. Like, I don't use recipes, unfortunately. But like, if you want to make a recipe, you want to make something and you want to get it perfectly right, you follow a recipe to the tilt, right? Am I right or not?
Yeah.
Right. So if I don't know something, I don't know the path to going back to Krishna, Vedas are a way by which it gives you ki ye ye karo and then you'll go back to Krishna. However, a person who's completely realized, who is in complete pure transcendental devotional service, does not need that. But hum log us stage pe nahi hai. So since you're not on that stage, the Vedas have been written and given to us so that we can read them and figure out how to go back to Krishna, because it's a code. It gives you different ways by which you can go back to Krishna.
Okay. Thank you, Ma.
Hare Krishna. I saw Hare somebody Krishna. Else unmuting. Hare Krishna, Mataji. Anybody else that has a question? Nothing. Kuch nahi.
No,
can we proceed? Okay, yes, Ramakrishna Mataji. You have a question?
Yeah, Hare Krishna Mataji. I didn't get the name of Krishna's uncle in the Vandanam for that example.
What was that it? Let me begin.
The nine angas of Bhakti.
Akrura. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Mataji. Akrura. Thank you, Mataji.
Okay. I see Uma Kannan Mataji, Jigna Mataji, Swati Mataji. Questions or you want to read?
Yeah, question.
Mataji. Yes, Mataji. Go ahead. Okay, Mataji, what's the question?
I would like to ask that whether in Krishna consciousness, first we have to follow the Vedas and Yajnas, and then we have to approach to Krishna, or directly we can approach.
Here how are you that when you say here, directly approach, how what is the direct way, Mataji?
Direct way means only chanting.
Yeah, so you come into the transcendental stage. Krishna is saying, you know, what is the purpose of the Vedas? The purpose of the Vedas is to know Krishna. However, if you get into the stage where you are in complete devotional service of Krishna, you don't have to. But are you in that stage, Mataji? Are we like completely dedicated to Krishna? If we are not a realized soul, then for us to get to that particular stage, Vedas help you go get there.
Okay. Thank you, Mataji.
Okay. Umakannan Mataji, any questions?
No, Mataji, I wanted to read. That's why.
Sure. So Swati Mataji has already read, na? So let's lower our hand. Jigna Mataji, I saw your hand raising first. So can I have her read first, please?
Okay, Hare Krishna Mataji.
Okay, next one.
Evam pravartitam chakram nano vartya yatya yaha adhara yuri indrayaranu mokam partha swajivati. Purport. My dear Arjuna, a man who does not follow this prescribed Vedic system of sacrifice certainly leads a life of sin, for personal delighting only in the sense lives in vain. Purport. The mnemonist for philosophy of work, very hard and enjoy sense gratifications, is condemned hereby in by Lord. Therefore, for those who wants to enjoy this material world, the above mentioned cycle of performing yajnas is absolutely necessary. One who does not follow such regulation is living a very risky life, being condemned more and more. By nature law, this human form of life is specially meant for self-realization. In either of the three ways, namely karma yoga, jnana yoga and bhakti yoga, there is no necessity of rigidity following the performance of the prescribed yajnas. For the transcendentalists who are above vice and virtue, but those who are engaged in self-gratification requires purification by above mentioned cycle of yajna performances. This are the different kind of activities. Those who are not Krishna conscious are certainly engaged in sensory consciousness. Therefore, they need to execute pious work. The yajna system is planned in such a way that the sensory conscious person may satisfy their desire without becoming entangled in the reaction of sense gratificatory work. The prosperity of the world depends not on your own efforts, but on the background arrangement of the Supreme Lord, directly carried out by the demigod. Therefore, the yajnas are directly aimed at the particular demigod mentioned in the Vedas. Indirectly, it is the practice of Krishna consciousness, because when one masters the performance of yajnas, one is sure to become Krishna conscious. But if by performing yajnas one does not become Krishna conscious, such principles are counted as only moral codes. One should therefore limit his progress only to the point of moral codes, but should transcend them to attain Krishna consciousness. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you so much. So here Krishna is saying, my dear Arjuna, a man who does not follow his prescribed Vedic system of sacrifice certainly leads a life of sin. For a person delighting only in the senses lives in vain. So what does that mean? Mataji, I think I was hearing in her class, and she said the first time she read this verse, she was like, अरे यार लाइक इज माय लाइफ रियली अ सिन बिकॉज आई एम नॉट कीपिंग कृष्णा इन सेंटर ऑफ ऑल द एक्टिविटीज दैट आई एम डूइंग. So at some point of time, all of us come to that realization, because what we have done, at least I, when I started this journey, what did I do? It's like, that's a general concept, you know, you work really hard and you save up for your family, you save up for this. If I am a working workaholic and I'm doing work, right? I'm just constantly working. I'm taking care of family. I'm doing my best at the job. Then I'll go back to the Godhead. But here, it's a complete opposite. It says, like, if you don't put Krishna in... Krishna in center of everything that you're doing, then your life is not really, you know, it's kind of going in waste. So what you have to do is do your activities and do your activities in such a way that you're involving Krishna in what you're able to do. One of the things, what is it saying? Because we are in this material world and we want to basically still enjoy the fruits of our activities, what the yajnas do is the yajnas help us regulate our nature. And that is why we can, by following the yajnas or scriptures, what it is doing is it helps us come to the stage of self-realization through different things. And it is a step ladder that I think Mataji had shared a few different times. How does the sequence of steps go up? You first do about what is better than working, not working, and then there's working. So if you're just sitting, you know, as a lazy person, then that is the worst case scenario. At least if you're working and working in such a way that, you know, I'm working, I'm using my senses. And then even though I am working for my own sense gratification, I'm still working. So that is a higher stage than not working or being completely, you know, a burden on the society. That's a better stage, which is nothing but we call this as Karmakand. Then following Karmakand is a higher stage, which is Karma Yoga. I explained the difference between in Karma Yoga, there are two types. Who can tell me the difference of two types? Define what the type is. And tell me what's the difference between two. So there are two types of Karma Yoga. I think I've mentioned in the last class or the previous class. Somebody new. Let's see. Okay, Smita Mataji, you haven't spoken today.
Say that, can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah, Karma Yoga.
My question is, Karma Yoga is better than Karma Kand. What are the two types of Karma Yoga? Explain both of them to me.
According to me, one is doing a work, but not for Krishna, and one who is doing the work, and water is doing for the Krishna. So he is doing the work as allotted by Krishna, and being a Krishna conscious, he does for as a not for the fruit, but as a job for the Krishna.
Okay, so we need a little bit more clarification on Mataji. So let's see, Dr. Prakash.
There are two kinds of karma yoga, sakam karma yoga and niskam karma yoga. Sakam karma yoga is where you are doing a fruitative work. It means you are doing work and expecting to get the fruits of the work. Niskam karma or niskam karma yoga is where you do the work, but you do it in Krishna consciousness so that you don't expect any fruit out of it and you enjoy the work as itself.
Okay, Prabhu, there's a fine tuning there also. So let me give another chance. Ramashishi Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Mm-hmm. Sakkama Karma Yoga is attachment to the duty, attachment to the activity. I want to keep some part of the fruit, but then I want to offer something to Lord Krishna also. Whereas in Nishkama Karma Yoga, I'm attached to the activity, but giving the whole fruit to Krishna. I'm detached from the fruit of the activity.
Beautiful. So that is correct. So there are two types of Karma Yoga. One is Sakam Karma Yoga and the other one is Nishkam Karma Yoga. In both the Karma Yogas, I am attached to what I'm doing. I want to do that activity. So in Sakam Karma Yoga, I want the activity and I want the fruits of the activity. But I'm doing that work for my sense gratification. However, what I'm doing is, but the fruits that I'm getting, I'm donating a portion of that to Krishna consciousness. So that is Sakam Karma Yoga. Higher than Sakam Karma Yoga is Nishkam Karma Yoga. I am still attached to what I'm doing. I'm still attached to the activity, right? However, I am giving all the fruits of the activity for Krishna. So you have to understand the clear difference between how to explain both of them. So there, now that is also, it's not a higher stage. So once you come into the Karma Yoga stage, once you start reading scriptures, understanding scriptures and different things, you go on to a higher level of Jnana Yoga, where you try to understand a little bit more about the transcendental nature of the Lord. Higher than Jnana Yoga is Bhakti Yoga. So either you can take these ladder steps, or you can, you know, if you have the capability of going directly to the Bhakti Yoga stage, that is fine too. But there are different ways that have been prescribed by which you can come to the stage of self-realization. Now, because you might not be able to get there immediately, what are these yagnas which have been prescribed in the Vedas? They are step-by-step process so that it helps us control our sense gratification, which is what is prescribed here. And a lot of times we have to come to the realization that, you know, anything that I'm doing in this earth is not because of what I am doing, but because it is a background arrangement of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. By performing of these, the different yagnas, what is happening is one does not, but if performing yagna does not become Krishna conscious, at least such principles help us become a little bit more moral. So that becomes as a staging stone or stepping stone for us to come to that level of Krishna consciousness. So the yagnas are prescribed so that it can help us control our sense gratification or help us train our thought process in such a way that we get there. The end goal is what? End goal is for us to be in a Bhakti Yoga stage where we are in transcendental consciousness of Krishna. Our thought process is 24/7. You know, everything that we do is involving Krishna. But till we come to that particular stage, we are given different steps. You know, do this, then do this, then do this. So it's like taking baby steps, and you'll be able to come back there. Do you guys have any questions in this particular verse?
No, Madhaji, I haven't read it yet. Okay, Dr. Prakash, you are going to be reading the next one. Please raise your hand and keep it raised if you want to read.
Go ahead, Madhaji.
Okay, Madhaji. Yastvatma ratirevasyat Atma truttascha manavah Atmaneya evacha santushtas Tasya karyam na vidyate. Translation. One who is, however, taking pleasure in the self, who is illumined in the self, who rejoices in and is satisfied with the self only, fully satiated for him, there is no duty. Purport. A person who is fully Krishna conscious and is fully satisfied by his acts in Krishna consciousness no longer has any duty to perform. Due to his being Krishna conscious, all impiety within is instantly cleansed, an effect of many, many thousands of yajna performances. By such clearing of consciousness, one becomes fully confident of his eternal position in relationship with the Supreme. His duty thus becomes self-illuminated by the grace of the Lord, and therefore he no longer has any obligations to the Vedic injunctions. Such a Krishna conscious person is no longer interested in material activities and no longer takes pleasure in material arrangements like wine, woman, and similar infatuations. Hare Krishna Mataji, thank you.
Thank you, Hare Krishna, Mataji. So in this case, he's saying that one, as we mentioned in the previous verse, you know, there are different stages that you can come up to the Bhakti Yoga. But if you come, you can, without going through the steps, if you're able to transcendentally, you know, just being that Krishna conscious position directly through Bhakti Yoga by chanting and by, you know, but the different 9 stages of Bhakti that we had done, you are able to commit yourself to Krishna, then you don't have any, you no longer have any duty to perform. Now, if I were to ask somebody here, what does that mean? So if I become Krishna consciousness, if I become Krishna conscious and I come to the stage where I'm completely in transcendental consciousness of Krishna, I'm doing all activities that are in there, does that mean that I don't do any activity? Does it mean that I have to, isn't then people, Mayavadis, who talk about Krishna consciousness being inertia, what is the context in which it's saying there's no longer any duty to perform? What does that mean? Ye interactive session hai, zara haath uthaye, baat karein, please. I want people who have not spoken. Please try. Uma Mataji, you haven't spoken today, have you? Uma Mataji, not Uma Kannan Mataji, just Uma Mataji.
Yeah, no, I have not spoken, Mataji.
Okay, Hare Krishna. So what do you think is being referred here?
Is it, I don't know whether I'm right, but is it, ma'am, that if when you're in Krishna consciousness, you give all the fruit of, you do all the work. It's not that you don't do any work. You do your duty, but whatever the fruit, whatever the, that you give it to Krishna, and you, whenever, I mean, that, and you spend time chanting Maha Mantra, eating prasad, and being in the company of pure devotees. Does it mean that, ma'am?
You are right. That's what they do. But here it's saying no longer he, you know, the first line that is highlighted saying no longer has any duty to perform. And then if you come down here, it says he no longer has any obligations to Vedic injunctions. So thank you for participating. I'll come back. Let me give a chance to a few other people. Please speak up. What do you think is your understanding here? Raise your hands, please. Varna, I'm going to start. Mishika Goyal Mataji, I think you were one of the first few to join the class. Unmute yourself, please.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Mataji, actually, I've not attended last 4 to 5 classes.
Yeah, no, that's fine. You're reading this line. I'm asking for participation. What do you think it means? It can be right, wrong. I don't care. Just say what you're thinking.
Mataji, could you please repeat the question?
So the question here is it's a highlighted thing on your screen, right? A person who's fully Krishna conscious has no longer any duty to perform. And then it also says on the line here, he no longer has any obligations to Vedic injunction. We just read that you have to follow the prescribed duty, which is prescribed in Vedas. And now here we are saying in the next few words that he does not have any duty to perform. You don't have any obligation to do the Vedic injunctions. Why do you think there's a contradiction here?
Maybe Mataji, I think it is suggested not to get attached to the fruits.
Okay, thanks for trying. And sorry for putting you on spot. I just want people to be comfortable enough to be able to speak. Okay, thank you. Sneha Mataji.
Mataji, as the devotee is totally involved in Krishna consciousness, he has to no longer, Krishna has totally accepted the devotee, and that's why he has neither, no longer has the duty to perform. I mean to say that.
Yeah, I'm getting the same answers, Mataji. I'm trying to get a different interpretation. Seema Mataji.
Mataji, what I think is, because he's already a Krishna conscious person, he is self-illuminated by the grace of God. Therefore, he has no obligation to Vedic injunctions.
Okay, can you give me any examples?
I think that's like Prahlad Maharaj.
Okay. So what was he performing? I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but I'm trying to bring out a point here.
No, the Prahlad Maharaj, he never forgot Krishna consciousness since his birth, even though his father was a demon, and he never liked his son, praying to Lord Krishna or doing any activities towards Krishna. But that never changed his behavior, Prahlad's behavior towards Krishna. So I think he's so self-illuminated and he's so focused that he wanted only Krishna and nothing else. So I think that's what I understand from this.
Sure. Thank you, Mataji. Simi Mataji, go ahead.
Mataji, I feel that if you are self-realized and if you are an enlightened soul, then you are not obliged to perform any Vedic duty. And example, Mataji, I don't know if I'm right, but I remember Vema Mataji saying something about like, is it that a student, you know, when he goes to university, he has to follow the prescribed rules of the university. And once he gets a degree, I think then he doesn't have to follow the rules or something. Was it that example? I don't know. But it's something like that. I mean, once he's reached that certain level of an enlightened soul, then I don't think he has to follow the Vedic duties, or he's already aware of everything. So he's above that. So that's what I presume.
Okay. I don't know the university example. Go back and check your reference. I don't think so. I could be wrong. But so here, thank you for all participation. Please lower your hands so that then I understand who wants to read. Lower it and then you can lower it up back. I think it was chapter one. Yeah, chapter one, we were talking about, you know, the elders in the family being killed. We read a particular verse which said about what the, because what do the elders in the family do? They tell the youngsters in the family to be able to perform different scriptures or perform different functions. And one of the functions on that is for the souls, our ancestors who have not gotten moksha, what are you supposed to do? It is, you know, at certain days of the month, what do we do? We offer Krishna Prasadam to them for the... And the souls who are out there are liberated, right? So one for yajnas or one concept. So that is one of the things that we do, because that is prescribed in the Vedas, that you offer Krishna Prasadam, and by eating, offering the Krishna Prasadam, these liberated souls, our ancestors who might not have gotten a gross body, will be, get liberated and will be able to do that. Who have not gotten, or who are just roaming around in their subtle body, will have the ability to get a gross body. However, Krishna, because that is prescribed in the Vedas. However, a person who becomes Krishna conscious not only liberates himself, liberates generations before and after him. So that was an example I was looking for, because what it says is, what are the purpose of the Vedas? The purpose of the Vedas is to know Krishna. So all your arguments are correct. The example that I was looking for is, okay, this is prescribed in the Vedas. Do this, 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 this. But because you become self-Krishna conscious, that's the only example that could come to my head was, you know, we offer food to our ancestors, but a person who becomes Krishna conscious does not have to do that, because he became Krishna conscious, he liberates generations before and generations after that. So that's how you have to understand it. It doesn't mean that Krishna conscious becomes inertia. It just means that a person who is self-eliminated, as like all of you said, then they don't have to perform a Vedic injunction to be able to come to that stage, because they're already in that particular stage. Umagana Mataji, did you have a question or did you want to read again?
Yes, Mataji, I have a question, Mataji.
Go ahead.
Can we say that Sukadev Goswami was all liberated in the womb of his mother itself? So can that also be an example? I just wanted to ask, Mataji.
I don't know the whole story, Mataji, so hold on. Where is Roshan? Did Roshan leave or he is here? I would assume so, Mataji, he's not here, but I think my answer would be yes. Did he, in the womb itself, because he knew, because he was hearing about it in the mother's womb, right? So if I have to go with that reference,
yes,
then I would say yes. And he did not want to come out because I know this life is meaningless. I don't want to. And then Krishna himself had to come and ask him to come. And what do you think he did the first thing? He just ran and ran and ran. And he said, I am going to go and I'm going to start my process of going back to Krishna. So hence, I would assume that he was liberated when in the womb itself.
Okay, Mataji. Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Sneha Mataji, did you have a question?
No, Mataji, I just want to read.
Okay, one second, Mataji. Kusum Mataji, did you have a question? Kusum Lata Mataji, you're unmuted. Did you have a question? Okay.
No, Mataji, no question.
Okay. Swati Mataji, did you already read?
Can I?
Oh, yes, Prabhu, one second. I just want to make sure. I just saw some raised hands. Sneha Mataji will read the next one. Prakash Prabhu, please go ahead.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Naiva tasya krute natho na krute neha kaschana na chasya sarva bhuteshu kaschit ascha vyapascha. Translation. A self-realized man has no purpose to fulfill in the discharge of his prescribed duties, nor has he any reason not to perform such work, nor has he any need to depend on any other living being. Purport. A self-realized man is no longer obliged to perform any prescribed duty, save and expect and accept activities. in Krishna consciousness. Krishna consciousness is not inactivity either, as will be explained in the following verses. A Krishna conscious man does not take shelter of any person, man or demigod. Whatever he does in Krishna consciousness is sufficient in the discharge of his obligation. Thank you, Mother.
Go ahead, Hare Krishna Prabhu. Can you read, because these two are connected, can you read the next verse also?
Sure. Tammadamakta sanat satanaha karya karma samachara asakto dvacharan karma paramat propti purushaha. Translation. Therefore, without being attached to the fruits of activities, one should act as a matter of duty for by working without attachment, one attains the supreme purport. The supreme is the personality of Godhead for the devotees and liberation for the impersonalist. A person therefore acting for Krishna or in Krishna consciousness under purpose guidance and without attachment to the results of the work is certainly making progress towards the supreme goal of life. Arjuna is told there that he should fight in the battle of Kurukshetra for the interest of Krishna, because Krishna wanted him to fight. To be a good man or a non-violent man is a personal attachment, but to act on behalf of the Supreme is to act without attachment for the result. That is perfect action of the highest degree, recommended by the Supreme Personality of the Godhead of Sri Krishna. Vedic rituals like prescribed sacrifices are performed for purification of impious activities that were performed in the field of sense gratification. But action on Krishna consciousness is transcendental to the reactions of God, or reactions of the good or evil work. A Krishna conscious person has no attachment for the result, but acts on behalf of the Krishna alone. He engages in all kinds of activities, but completely non-attached. Hare Krishna Mataji.
Thank you so much for reading, Prabhu. So in the previous verse, which was here, it's saying a self-realized man is no longer obliged to perform any prescribed duty, save and except activities in Krishna consciousness. So it is not inertia. Krishna consciousness is not inactivity, as we discussed before. It is activity, but what is happening in those activities are we are doing an activity and just submitting all the results of the activity to Krishna. And I think it is one of the Vaishnava prayers. I can't remember the reference for it, but on the prayers it says that, I think we will be reading. We were reading in Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And one of the verses on there it says, Srila Narottama Das Thakur says that as Vaishnavas are prevented from worshipping any demigods, because the demigods are nothing but they're very merciful. So if you pray to them, they'll give you whatever you need. So for example, you pray to Lord Goddess Lakshmi, she gives you wealth. But with that wealth, what you could generally do is you could take the wealth and, you know, use it towards spreading Krishna consciousness. However, with the same wealth, what you can also get is you can get materially attached to it, saying, my family, my thing, I want to save more. That can happen too. Srila Narasimha Thakur says on that particular verse is, if you are a pure Vaishnava, do not pray to demigods, make sure you pray to Krishna himself alone. So here I'm trying to think, is like, that's why the line which is mentioned here is, a Krishna conscious man does not take any shelter of any person or any demigod, because them getting Krishna conscious is sufficient enough to, you know, make them go back to Goloka. Now, what is being prescribed in the next particular verse is, it's saying that the Supreme is Krishna can be understood actually in three different ways. We read this in chapter 2. So who can tell me, based upon my realization or based upon a devotee's realization of what Krishna is, we understand Krishna in three particular forms. What are the three particular forms? This is, I think, verse 2.2. Raise your hands, please. Based upon our level of understanding, we understand Krishna or the Lord or the Supreme in three different phases. चैप्टर थ्री आ गए तो चैप्टर टू भूलना नहीं चाहिए. ओके, लेट्स सी, आई डोंट सी एनी न्यू रेज्ड हैंड्स. सबने आंसर किया हुआ है क्या? सिर्फ चार पांच लोग पढ़ रहे हैं. एवरीबडी शुड रीड. मीरा माता जी, डिड यू आंसर टुडे?
यस, आई डिड.
ओके, लेट्स सी, एनीबडी न्यू?
मैम, कैन आई?
श्योर, गो अहेड माता जी.
I think Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagwan.
Okay, so what is Brahman feature?
Brahman is I think it's impersonal or pervasive spirit. Paramatma, or localized aspect of Supreme without the heart of all living entities. Ma'am, I'm just reading from the book. I'm telling you, I don't remember. No, because this is.
I like your honesty. Thank you.
No. What it is, I should be very honored because I don't remember.
And, you're fine. At least you at least opened your book and went back to 2.2. So that's okay.
Sorry. And Bhagwan, or Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna.
Right. So based upon our realization, I'm sorry, that was really cute, but thank you. So based upon our level of realization, we understand Krishna in three different ways. A lot of people generally, when they're first coming into devotional service, understand Krishna as, like, you know, some kind of a power. That is the Brahman feature. Once we keep moving up in our journey, we understand that, oh, Krishna exists in us, in our heart, and the Paramatma feature. Now, when we are completely dedicated, our perfect understanding of Krishna is when we understand Krishna is not a power, Krishna is the person. That is the Bhagwan feature that's associated. So here they're saying that the Supreme Personality of Godhead can be, for a devotee, they understand Krishna as a person. But for the person who's kind of like the Mayavadi feature, they understand Krishna in the Brahman feature. So whatever might be the way that they're understanding it, it is very critical that you get this guidance or understanding of Krishna from a proper guidance, like from a proper acharya who is in the proper parampara. So there is no... there's no personal motivation associated with that. So when we come to these classes, you know, what are we propagating? We are propagating information which has been come down through disciplinic succession. Because only when we do that, then we get to the attack, then we start understanding it the way it was meant to, and also make progress, because by doing this as a constant practice, just because you're hearing, you're not going to be able to do that. You hear and try and execute what you can in your life, so that we start doing activities which will, we start doing activities which involves Krishna in it, and we start doing activities, and maybe we come to the stage where we do not get attached to the result of our work. So that is a step-by-step process that we do, and you will be able to do it only if you're under the proper guidance of an acharya. And here, we are learning it from Srila Prabhupada, who has, you know, the disciplinic succession that we rank up to Krishna for it. So that's the process about why you have to hear from a proper channel, proper guru, and a Vedic disciplinic succession. You have to hear it from them and not from anybody and everybody. So also, we come to the concept of where, you know, like I think in the previous few verses we were talking about, we've all been groomed up at least to say, you know, let's do a work. and do work, do good, be, you know, be good at your job, be good as a parent, be good as a child, be good as everything. And if you do that, then yes, you go back to Krishna. Krishna, they say, no, that might not be the purpose of life. The purpose of life is to make sure that your life is Krishna centric. And how do you do that? Yes, you can chant, you can read, but it's a training of a mind, which doesn't happen overnight. And I think one of the classes in the 18-day session, we were in the breakout room, when Mataji was really, was upset with her two teenagers saying that they were not listening to her and stuff like that. And I asked them a question. I don't know if I'm repeating the story, so I apologize. We are in different breakout rooms. If the story's repeating, I apologize for it. So I asked her, it's like, you know, are you chanting? Do you believe? And she said, yes. And then she said, it's like, okay, how many rounds are you chanting, ma'am? This is your first session. Are you chanting? She said, yeah, I get up in the morning and I say Hare Krishna and my day is made. So I was like, okay, you are attending the sessions. You understand chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And at least when we all started, at least I started with one round, but I understood the concept. And then you have to put it to practice. With the knowledge, nothing is going to happen, right? We have to put it into practice. That is the key. So now what do you tell them, person? Like here now, you know, I can pull all your legs and say, read, ye karo, wo karo, homework de sakti ho. 18-day session mein tumko bhagana nahi hai na. We are trying to build them into Krishna consciousness. So I said, I think I was pretty proud of my answer. I was like, Mataji, just think about, aapne ek bar Hare Krishna bola, right? Aapka din ban jata hai. Just think about the power that you have if you chant at least one round. Because what, you know, unless you practice it yourself, and if you're all family members here, your children are not going to be able to listen to you. So I've shared it in multiple classes here also. Like, you know, like I think Seema Mataji, you have your children come to the class, right? You have your children go into the children's class. Can you unmute yourself? Where did Seema Mataji go? Uh-oh. Okay, when she comes back, she'll share. But when I started chanting, I went up to like 6 or 7 rounds. And my son was like, kya karte rehte ho? Maine kaha, then I asked him to wait. Like I asked him I waited till he asked me the question. And then we now in the evening do one round and we read your book. Unless you set up an example yourself, your children are not going to be able to follow it. So the end of the day, what we think is good, what we think is bad, is just our personal concoction. That is not what Krishna is looking for. I think I read it in one of the line. Where is it saying? Yeah, to be good man or to be non-violent is a personal attachment. But the work that has to be done for us to go back to Krishna has to be done because it is in Krishna consciousness or attachment without the result of the activity. So Krishna here is saying to Arjuna, do the work. Don't do a work because you want to do it. Do a work because I am telling you to do it. So that act will then become purified. It is not good or evil or anything that is more morals, you know, that is more of a moral subjunction associated with that. Because what is the difference? If I do a good activity and if I do impious activity, does that offset each other? If I were to ask the question, I have given this answer. I've repeated this multiple times here. So if I do some pious activity and I do some unpious activity, do they offset each other? What's the answer to that question?
No, Mataji.
Why, Mataji?
See, for pious activity you are doing right now, but whatever you had done previously, you have to suffer for that. It is not going to compensate. This is what you mean, right?
Okay. Why? How do I suffer?
Of course, by past deeds, what I have done, or right now, what I am doing. So, जो कर्म किया है तो वो भोगतना पड़ेगा मतलब whatever past is I have done sufferings so I have to go through
correct but you know those can be offset by doing work that is in Krishna consciousness. So the answer that I was looking for was when you do a pious activity you get some credits. I've repeated this multiple times in the class. What do you do with those credits? You with those credits you get heavenly planets. You go enjoy there. Jab credit khatam ho gaya, wapas aa jao. Where do you come back to the material earth? You go through the birth, age, old age, disease, right? Let's say you're doing unpious activity. What happens? Punishment to suffer karna padega. You what do? You go to the hellish planets, suffer the consequences, and then come back. Apna goal kya hona chahiye? It's like I don't want to come and get a birth again, yeah. I want to go back to Krishna, being Goloka and in constant service of Krishna. How do I do that? So good, bad, good, evil, this is all immaterial. Our goal should be to go back to Krishna. And how do you go back to Krishna is to do certain activities which do not have a reaction. So just because you're doing a good activity or a bad activity, it is not going to offset each other. You have to do activities in Krishna consciousness which do not have a reaction. And an example of that is like hearing about Krishna. This activity will not have a reaction. With doing such kind of activities, somebody's TV is going on. So when you do such kind of activities, you're again developing a credit. But with that credit, what is happening? That credit never expires. So that credit keeps increasing. And then if you have enough to buy a ticket to Goloka, then you go back there. But even if in this lifetime you are not able to come to the stage where you're not able to go back to Goloka, that credit stays there. Let's say if it was 10% of the credits that were needed, you have to come back to the material earth to start this journey all over again, you start at 10%. You don't go back to square one. कौन सी डिग्री कॉलेज यूनिवर्सिटी में होता है कि तुमने दो साल कर लिया एंड देन यू कैन कम बैक एंड यू कैन स्टार्ट एट द सेकेंड ईयर नो यू हैव टू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम द बिगनिंग बट एनी एक्टिविटी दैट यू आर डूइंग इन कृष्णा कॉन्शियसनेस व्हाटएवर एक्टिविटी यू हैव डन इफ यू आर नॉट एबल टू फिनिश दैट प्रोसेस इन दिस बर्थ यू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम द प्लेस वेयर यू फिनिश्ड ऑफ नॉट फ्रॉम द स्क्रैच कुसुम माता जी डिड यू वॉन्ट टू रीड और डिड यू हैव अ क्वेश्चन I see raised hands and then I see all of you. Kusum Mataji, I just saw your hands raising. Did you need to read or did you have a question?
Hello, I have a question. In Kali Yuga, chanting of the name, they say they washes the bad karmas of past. That's why chanting is more important than any other thing.
Chanting is more important than any other thing. Yes, Mataji. Yes. There's a little background noise going on in your background, Mataji.
And there's a practical proof in personal experience.
I can't hear you, Mataji. There's a little background. You said, is chanting the best way? Yes, chanting is the best way in this Kali Yuga.
Yeah. They say they wash the previous bad karma and chanting is more important than any other thing.
And I answered, yes.
That is correct in one way. That is personal experience.
Okay, so you're not asking a question, you're just sharing, Mataji, is that what it is?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry, I'm going to just have mute you. There's too much background noise on it.
There's too much background, some repair activity is going on.
Sorry. Okay, thank you. Okay, Jigna Mataji, you were going to ask a question. What is your question?
Mataji, I know it is not related, just that man, when some beggar comes and if you give some money to them, okay, and from that money, if they go drink something like they do smoking or they spend in different way, which is not good. So what about the karma? That karma comes to me or how it goes off?
Now you're not going to go behind a beggar to see what they're doing, right, Mataji? So it's a very, very tricky question, if I may ask. So in that case, instead of giving them money, can you just give them food?
Ma'am, every time, see, that is what I think, that food is must. But at times, even they need money. Sometimes they want to buy medicine or something like that. Then who is going to give money to them? So that is what I think. So sometimes I give them food. Sometimes I give them money. But so that I don't get the karma. Suppose they spend on some in this respectful way. So I should not get that karma. So how is it possible to avoid that?
Well, you can't, as I mentioned, Mataji, practically, it's quite impossible to go back and track it, right? So when you're doing it, so for example, are you looking at like just somebody in the, like when you're on the roads and they're asking you for money or somebody that's in the house?
Very old person, old lady is there or some small baby is there who is disabled. That way I give money. Depends upon the person, not the elder, but not the medium age person because they can walk. I just go for elderly, very elderly people, generally elderly people.
So generally, elderly people are not going to go drink. Mataji, I can't answer that question. But, you know, keep your intent as the way of helping out as the same. And then unfortunately, we can't control the activities of other people, right? But theoretically, yes, if they misuse it, does it come back to you as a karma? I think Krishna will take care of you if your intent was to help out in the right way. Now, if you purposely see a drunkard and you're giving money to him without knowing, and you know for a fact that he's going to be using it to go drink, then yes, that karma comes on you. But if you give it to an old lady who's, you know, who needs it for some medicine, unless you can buy the medicine yourself and give it, then give the money, and then it is up to them what they do. But you're not giving it to them to, you know, to encourage them to use sinful activities, then the karma should not come to you. But you can bring this up. Mataji comes back next week for you guys, so you can bring it up. But theoretically, the answer is, if you can do it in a way where it is Krishna conscious, like either giving food or something like that, or if you're giving it for a particular medication, see if you can, you know, buy the medicine and give it to them, but you really don't know. As long as intentionally you're not giving it to somebody that is going to misuse it, because, you know, on the roads you see a lot of beggars who are asking, and you can see physically that they're drunk. Unless you're encouraging that kind of a behavior, I don't believe the karma comes back to you.
Okay, Mataji. Thank you, Mataji.
Okay, Dr. Prakash, did you need to chime in something?
Hare Krishna, Mataji. I just wanted another perspective on this question. What I thought is, when you give a money to a beggar, that becomes your karma of donation. And then if beggar goes and drinks, that is his karma of utilizing the money. So your karma stops as soon as you have given money with good intention as a donation. But whatever further he does with that money becomes his karma. No, you are not connected with it.
Okay. Sure, Mata Prabhu. Smita Mataji. Your hand is raised, Mataji.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Mataji.
Yeah. I don't agree with what he's saying. That's why I raised the hand. Giving funds to an unwanted place is not the correct thing. So that becomes your wrong karma.
Mataji, he didn't say incorrect things. What he said was, when we do an activity and we're doing it with our intent, then it is our karma. That becomes our good activity. He's not saying he's giving it to somebody who's misusing it. As long as, and that is what I stated previously to Mataji, Mataji also, as long as I am giving with a good intent and I know I'm trying to give it to a person who is, who is, at least from my knowledge, I'm giving it to them with the intent that they're going to use it for a medication or anything like that, that's fine. But if they turn around and give it to their spouses who's going to get drunk, I did not give it with that intention. The karma comes to me. You know, let's not discuss this further, because that's not something that is not under control, right? So the simple logic is, when I'm giving it, I see a person who's a drug addict and he's sitting there and he has a board saying, give me money because I need it. If you're giving money there knowing that he's going to drink or knowing he's going to take drugs, that is a donation which is given in the mode of ignorance. So that karma will come to me. However, if I'm doing it, I'm seeing an old lady, she's hungry and she wants medication or food. Unless I can buy that food and medication and give it to them, and they need, they can, if I can do that, that's well and good. But if I can't do that and I'm giving them the money, I don't know what else she's going to do with that. I'm trying to give it with a good intent. I don't believe that karma comes to us. But we can have this discussion later on about that. We all think about things that are, you know, what if, what if, what if. Bahut achhe achhe questions hote hain. But questions puchna ye chahiye ki what can I do right now? Main kitna padh rahi hoon? Main kitna samajh rahi hoon? Main kitna kar rahi hoon? That should be more of a goal, not questions about, are yaar ye karma hoga, nahi hoga. Those are things that are outside our control. Why think about things that are outside my control? Think about things what I can do right now. Mera life ka funda bahut simple hai. Bahut hi zyada simple hai. Jo kar sakte ho, wo karo. Jo out of hand hai, wo Krishna dekh lega. Sneha Mataji, would you like to read? You should be able to do two more, yaar. Would you like to read, or did you have a question?
No, I would like to read.
Go ahead, Mataji.
Sorry, Mataji, I have a question.
Go ahead, Mataji.
And can you just go back a little bit? That highlighted portion of text, purport. Yeah, to be a good man or a non-violent man is a personal attachment. Could you please explain, like, what it means here?
Yeah, I as I mentioning Mataji, to be good or non-violent bent is what I. मैं सोचती हूँ ऐसे करने से it is good. मैं सोचती हूँ ऐसे करने से I will be good. That is my personal motivation. What is Krishna? What is Arjuna saying on the battlefield? He's saying, oh no. I cannot talk back to elders. I cannot talk back to my teachers. I cannot talk back to my grandfather. Right? That is his personal attachment because that is his. I don't want to kill them. I can die for them, but I can't kill them. So that is his moral principle. But what is Krishna saying? Krishna is saying, get up and fight. Get up and fight because that is my order to you. So do not get stuck between, there's a very fine line between what is moral and what is spiritual, right? And anything that you're doing. So this war that Arjuna is fighting is a spiritual war. And anything that you do, because we are so attuned to it, you know, like, papa, mami se unchi awaaz mein baat nahi karo. Do not disrespect them. You cannot talk back to them. Those are things, the moral qualities that a good society teaches us, correct? Is that true or not, Mataji?
Correct.
But Krishna is telling him at this stage, get up and fight. You have to kill them. They're not the body, they're the soul. He's using different logics, not to try and tell them ki why this war needs to be fought. So morally, it is incorrect to go back and kill your teachers. Morally, it is incorrect to go back and kill your grandfather. The grandfather who brought up you up after your father passed away, you going and killing them, that is morally incorrect. But it is spiritually correct because they were not on the right side of the war. That's what it means. Don't get stuck with non-violence. Main achhi hu, mereko ye nahi karna, mereko wo nahi karna. You get stuck in that cycle. So that is being a good man or a non-violent is a personal attachment. But here Krishna is saying, do what is right. And what is right is for Arjuna in this case is to fight the spiritual war. And how do I in our general life decide what is right or what is wrong? You just can't mentally concoct itself. So the context are there are three things you have to refer to. Sadhu, Sangha, and Shastra. Was that the three ones? Yeah. So the scriptures, your devotees or association needs to approve of it. Your guru needs to approve of it. And the Shastras have to approve of it. And then you can understand that what your decision that you're doing is correct or wrong.
Did you understand? Because sometimes, you know. Yes, partly. What I didn't get is that, okay, in this case, Krishna was there in person to help Arjuna, like, you do this, this is what I want. But sometimes in life, you know, we are confused, like, what is the right thing? For instance, let me say something like this, I enroll for a course. Okay, I spend money, but halfway through it, I felt that this is not what I want to do, or I want to drop this course. But it is not fair, to do because my parents has already invested money in this. So many such confusing situations. Like,
like it is not whether right or wrong is not based upon what I think is right or wrong. That's why I said there are three things that have to be referred to it. And to make a personal decision on your behalf, that's not something that, you know, like somebody taking a class would be able to do. But the course is just a simple example, right? That's something that you can study if you wish to find to. But there are a lot more decisions that you'll have to come up in life where you don't know if it is right or wrong. So that's why you need to refer to the three things, Guru, Sadhu, and Shastra. So your spiritual master would be the one who would be able to give you an example associated with that, whether you're doing, whether the decisions that you make in life. Taking a course on all is like more material, but you'll have much more tougher decisions that you have to take in life. And for that, you will have to search out a spiritual master who would be able to, based upon understanding what your personal beliefs are, how you are personally motivated, they would be able to give you instructions on what needs to be done.
Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Sneha Mataji, you were reading. Please go ahead.
Okay. Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Padmanne vahi samsiddhi mastita janakadayaha lokasangrahamevapi sampashyan kartumahasi. Translation. Even kings like Janaka and others attain the perfectional stage by performance of prescribed duties. Therefore, just for the sake of educating the people in general, you should perform your work. Purport. Kings like Janaka and others were all self-realized souls.
Consequently, they had no obligation to perform the prescribed duties in the Vedas. Nonetheless, they performed all prescribed activities just to set examples for the people in general. Janaka was the father of Sita and father-in-law of the people in general. Janaka was the father of Sita and father-in-law of Lord Sri Rama. Being a great devotee of the Lord, he was transcendentally situated, but because he was the king of Mithila, a subdivision of Bihar province in India, he had to teach his subjects how to fight righteously in the battle. He and his subjects fought to teach people in general that violence is also necessary in a situation where good arguments fail. Before the battle of Kurukshetra, every effort was made to avoid the war, even by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But the other party was determined to fight. So for such a right cause, there is a necessity for fighting. Although one who is situated in Krishna consciousness may not have any interest in the world, he still works to teach the public how to live and how to act. Experienced persons in Krishna consciousness can act in such a way that others will follow, and this is explained in the following verse.
Let's read the next one also. Kushma Mataji, have you read today?
Mataji, I have a doubt.
On verse 20?
No, 17.
Okay, let's get back to it, Mataji. Let's finish this. Who else has not read today? Anybody else who would like to read 21? Actually, let me finish this first. Hold on. I'll come back to you, Krishna Mataji, so stay the course. Mita Mataji, okay, go ahead, read 21, then we'll read it together.
Shall I continue, ma'am?
No, actually, let Smita Mataji read. I don't think so, she read today. Go ahead, Mataji. Smita Mataji. Smita Mataji, unmute yourself.
Can you hear me?
Yes,
you
Mataji.
यद्यदाचरति श्रेष्ठ तत्तदेवेतरो जनः सयत् प्रमाणं कुरुते लोकस्ततनुवर्तते. Whatever action is performed by a great man, common men follow in his footsteps. And whatever standards he sets by exemplary acts, all the world pursues. Purport. People in general always require a leader who can teach the public by practical behavior. A leader cannot teach the public to stop smoking if he himself smokes. Lord Chaitanya said that a teacher should behave properly even before he begins teaching. One who teaches in that way is called Acharya or the ideal teacher. Therefore, a teacher must follow the principles of Shastra, scripture, to teach the common man. The teacher cannot manufacture rules against the principles of revealed scriptures. The revealed scriptures like Manusmriti and similar others are considered the standard books to be followed by human society. Thus, the leader's teaching should be based on the principles of the standard rules as they are practiced by the great teachers. The Srimad Bhagavatam also affirms that one should follow in the footsteps of great devotees, and that is the way of progress on the path of spiritual realization. The king or the executive head of a state, the father and the school teacher are all considered to be natural leaders of the innocent people in general. All such natural leaders have a great responsibility to their dependents. Therefore, they must be conversant with standard books of moral and spiritual codes.
Hare Krishna, Mataji, thank you so much. So these two verses are related, that's why we read. So here it says, even kings like Janaka. Janaka was a very sagely king. He's one of the first sagely kings that received the knowledge about Krishna also. So they are self-realized souls. So in the previous verses we read, if a person is self-realized, then they don't have any obligations or duties to perform, which are prescribed in the Vedas, because the goal of Vedas is to do what? The goal of Vedas is to become that self-realized person. But even though they are self-realized person, and what is the definition of self-realized? Self-realization is coming to the stage where I understand that I'm not the body, I'm not the body, but the soul. And I also come to the realization that I'm an internal servant of Krishna. Now, Lord Janaka, King Janaka was already that, but they still performed the prescribed duties because they had to set an example for their citizens to follow. And I'll refer it back to the previous verse that's on there. And in the same way, what they're also saying is they not only set an example for themselves, but example for the citizens, they also taught them when fighting was necessary or when violence was necessary, because violence does play a role in spirituality. So it's not about, you know, you take every beating and everything that comes thrown to your way. No, when the time comes and all options have been exhausted, you do need to pick up violence to be able to execute the will of the Lord. And the example that has been shared here is like, if I can give you the reference, before the battle of Mahabharata, Krishna himself went to Hastinapur and spoke to the king and his sons to say, yeah, they are all Kshatriyas. They cannot live in the jungle, or they cannot do, what is their intent, or what is their prescribed nature? What is their inherent ability? Their inherent ability is to rule. That is what a Kshatriya is. They want to be able to protect, they want to be able to manage. That is their inherent capability. That's why they're a Kshatriya. So don't give them kingdom. There are five brothers, give them five villages. Let them live in peace, let them manage, and they'll be fine. However, what is the answer that they're getting? They get an answer back saying, well, we'll not even give them a land which is as big as the tip of a needle, right? So now when all options have been exhausted, including Krishna, if he wanted with his just like, you know, with just his thought, the entire war would have been over. But he went because he wanted to set up an example that we did each and everything that was, you know, even available to us to try and see if this war was going to be prevented. But since that did not happen, then violence had to take place and the war had to be fought. Because when, and again, you have to look at the definition about, like, if Krishna did everything that in his power to avoid the war, we have to also come to the stage where we execute whatever we can to try and avoid a confrontation. But when the time comes, if it is prescribed by Guru, Sadhu, and Shastra, then we might also have to come to that particular stage. So self-realized person does not have to do any duty, but they do the duty because they want to set up an example. They set up an example like Lord, like King Janaka, because he wanted to set up an example for his citizens. Now, since he has set up an example, he also has to teach his citizens when is violence approved, when is not violence approved. And the example that I had just shared about even Krishna going above and beyond to see if he can prevent the war, but when, you know, he did not get any feedback or any positive response, that's when the war takes place. This is also an important verse because it says, yad yad acharati shrestha, like great men do, common men follow. That is why Krishna is telling him, saying, don't do it, don't leave the job, because one of the things he's saying is like, you know, I don't want the war, I don't want any kingdom, I'll go live in the jungle. But what is Krishna's argument back? He's saying, what are you doing? You are a great devotee. You are a great Kshatriya. People look up to you. People look up to you as an example. But what are you doing? If the first time you had like a mental dilemma that you had to face, if you get up and leave, are people going to talk about, what are your enemies going to talk about you? Are they going to say, oh, he was so compassionate, usne sab kuch chhod chhad ke chala gaya? Nope. The first thing that is going to come to their mind is what? It's going to come to their mind then, he is a coward and he ran away from a situation that he could not face. And what is the future generation going to do? What example are you setting it up for them? Not the killing of the elders and the family, but your example is going to be used and it will create Varna Shankara or unwanted population, because people are going to say, are yaar, Arjuna could not do this, then we are nothing, I'm not going to do the job because it is difficult for me. So do not set up a bad example, Arjuna, get up and fight is what is being said, because people looked up to him. And generally here they're talking about who's a leader. A leader is somebody that has to execute his behavior by a practical example. And with everybody of you, if you're family members, you are personal leaders yourselves in your household. So if you want, and if you're getting a resistance in your household about being Krishna conscious, do the activity. Forget about what other people are doing. Are yaar, ye nahi kar raha, wo nahi kar raha. I wanted my mom to join. I want my sister to join. They're not doing it. Don't worry about it. Do what you can. you will see a change in yourself first, and people will see a change in you, and they will come and ask. There is a time and place for everything, right? There's a time and place for everything. They will see the change in you. They will see the behavioral changes in you, or something is happening where they will come and ask. When they're ready to listen, then tell them. But set up your own example. We don't have to be Arjuna. We can all be our own, or we can be all our own Arjunas in our own household. Lead by example. And Lord Chaitanya is saying is like anybody who's a teacher should behave properly before even they begin teaching. And because he is a guru, he cannot make up his own rules. It's like, I think so. Wo nahi hona chahiye. What is said, what is written has to be followed to the T. You cannot have a personal motivation on the scripture. Whatever has to be said in terms of a scripture. So the example that was said was, you know, if somebody is smoking and you are asking the other person to non-smoke, what do you think is going to be your reaction? It's like, pehle khud band kar lo, uske baad karenge. Similarly, if you want your children to chant or your family members to chant, first chant yourself. See the difference in you and then you can preach. We are all not at that particular stage where we can, you know, try and preach by just saying. We may be at a stage where we are able to influence other people by our own behavior, by our own practice. That should be the goal. So, and I think it says here is in even Srimad, a leader's teaching should be based on the principles of the standard rules that they're practiced by great teachers. So look up to your teachers, look up to your acharyas, see what their behavior is and try and follow it. Because a true acharya would be somebody whose achar and prachar are the same. What he preaches and what he practices should be one and the same. Then they're the right people that you can be following. And such natural leaders like King Janaka had the responsibility towards the dependents. Hence, they followed scriptures, even though they were realized souls and did not have to follow it. They still followed the prescribed duty so that they could set up an example for others to follow. I think we have 5 minutes past you. That would be for today. Please read till 22. Let's read till 37 maybe. I'll put it up in the group. And I'll take up some questions. Mataji, go ahead. You said you had a question. Or any questions in these two verses before we go back? Itna silence, yaar. Maine sula diya sabko. Wake up, class
khatam
ho gaya. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Mataji, go ahead.
Mataji, not a doubt, but a compliment. The text 21 was very, very, you know, beautifully explained by you. Very beautiful.
Thank you. Who had a question? Somebody said they had a question.
Mataji, I only had a question, but and 17, not...
Okay.
Mataji, just a small question, just for my understanding. Now, the text 17, it explains about the person who is already a Uttam Adhikari. Is it referring to that?
Okay, yeah.
That's my question. Is it because he's already, the first line which you explained first and... the last line, it's very similar to the person who's already taken up, the devotee who has taken up sannyas and probably has attained the level of Uttam Adhikari. Is that right?
Uttam Adhikari is the highest level of devotee, Mataji. I don't believe they have to be in sannyasa to be able to reach Uttam Adhikari. A devotee, a grihastha can be in that stage too.
Then Mataji, this devotee who has attained what level is this? I don't know. Then how do we categorize this?
Mataji, you are in ISO class, I am assuming. So you have the different levels of adhikaris, right? The different stages of devotees. So if we keep it simple, a person who is Uttam Adhikari is a devotee who is in transcendental consciousness of Krishna. Is that yes or no?
Yes.
Does it say anywhere in ISO? I think you're reading ISO Upanishad. So does it say anywhere that he has to be in sannyas?
No.
No. So I'll give you an example that Mataji had once shared. Srila, I think it was Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada or his Acharya. I am bad. I remember stories. I forget the references. So let's assume it was Srila Prabhupada's Acharya. And they were, you know, the, he used to spend, his Acharya used to spend a lot of time with one specific devotee who was a Grihastha. And the other Brahmacharis who were living with him, they were, you know, getting a little jealous. Are yaar, like we have given our life and Acharya is spending more time with this Grihastha. So they go up to his Acharya and say, you know, like we really have this doubt. Why are you spending more time with the Grihastha versus these Brahmacharis who have devoted their life to you? So the Acharya says, okay, do me a favor, go in the middle of the night, not in the evening or anything like that. Go in the middle of the night and knock on the door and ask the Grihastha to say, you know, something happened with Acharya and Acharya needs money. Otherwise, his life is going to be in peril. He's going to die. What does the Grihastha do? Grihastha gets up, goes to his wife, takes out all his jewelry and gives it to this this person. Then he comes back and says, well, this Grihastha did it. Like, but a Grihastha is what? Grihastha is somebody who is, you know, just taking care of his family, but he's still in transcendental consciousness of Krishna and his Acharya. Then the same devotee who asked the question comes back and says, well, Brahmachari should be a little bit more realized than that, right? So he goes like, okay, do me a favor, get up in the morning when the Brahmacharis are going to take a bath in the morning in the river, go and see what is happening there. So the devotee goes up and sees, and वहाँ पे क्या हो रहा होता है कि you know the devotees are fighting over cloth, which is the langot, because they're supposed to wear a langot rather than like, you know, undergarments and stuff like that. So that's when the devotee realizes that surrender to Krishna is not dependent upon what ashrama they are in. It depends upon your true self. So here, they might be in the Uttamadhikari stage, but they don't have to be in like in a particular ashrama or anything like that. So very simply put, a person who's in Krishna consciousness, I gave you an example of Lord Janaka, right? In the next verses, he is completely Krishna conscious. He's in the transcendental stage. He does not have to do any duty. The duty here means it's not doing any work, but doing work that is constantly in Krishna. Because, and doing duty as prescribed in the Vedas. Why do you do a duty which is prescribed in the Vedas? Is because you're doing that duty so that you can become Krishna conscious. Well, if you're already Krishna conscious, do you have to do the duty? Nahi. But you still do it. Like kings like King Janaka still did it because yes, they became Krishna conscious, but they have to do what? They're the leaders of a particular bunch of citizens, right? They have to show them by their own examples. That's what the other phrase is. Yad yad, arey yaar, main se zindagi mein na jis din pronounce karungi wo acha hai. I remember the exactly. So set lead by example. That's what they're saying here.
Okay.
Oh. Can I, Meera here?
Yes, Mataji.
Just to add to this, is it the gopis who were with Krishna, they were the true examples of such a devotee, transcendental, like, you know, they were always thinking, even when they were working and whatever work they used to do, they were always in thinking of Krishna, isn't it?
That's an example, Mansuji, they're an example of true devotee, yeah, but here the example that she was asking for is, they don't have to do any work, so what is the example then?
Sannyasi, what I mean to say is...
They don't have to be a sannyasi to be Uttamadhikari. Yeah, I get that. Yes.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Any other questions today? Or... Arey yaar, 10 minute over ho gaya. You guys have other things to do. I'll stick around for a few minutes. If you have any questions, please let me know. Jigna Mataji, did I finish answering your question?
No, Mataji, but it has happened. Actually, something is wrong with my phone. Sorry.
I know, I apologize. You put in the chat. I think you did ask your question, right? Or unless you have another question, go ahead. I can't hear her. Okay. Any other questions? You all have the power to unmute yourself. I'll stick around for a few minutes. Otherwise, thank you for coming. Please read. Read and come back. Yes, Mataji, Smita Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Nothing to say now.
Hare Krishna, Madani.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, everyone.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.